Welcome to Opinion Nation.
And we stand today on the edge of a new frontier.
There is nothing wrong with America that cannot be cured by what is right with America.
What makes us Americans is our shared commitment to an ideal that all of us are created equal.
I, too, am America.
Now here's your host, Bryce Robbins.
Hello, everybody. What a beautiful Saturday morning from sunny New Jersey. I am not getting cancer from the air yet, but we will see, because today I'm going to talk about actually a story from my state, New Jersey, in regards to the environment, into the giant oil company ExxonMobil. But first, before I actually get into that, I'm actually just going to kind of talk a little bit about what I've been seeing in the news lately, and a quick couple things that I've been seeing on Twitter lately. A big thing that I've seen is, you know, in regards to Iran, and I will return to this, I'm kind of confused on it myself, how the United States should actually go in regards to Iran, because we see that, you know, Benjamin Netanyahu makes a very clear argument, and I will get into that a little later. But Iran also makes a pretty compelling argument, and it's also a historical argument that maybe the United States should look into. So I encourage you, stick with us, and we will get into that soon. We're already running a little late here, so you know what? I'll just probably jump into my cover story. So ExxonMobil, the biggest company in the United States and around the world, netting $44 billion in in revenue each year. They've actually topped themselves as the number one company, most profitable company in the world three times over. They've broken their record then subsequently three times. And, you know, they are worth a lot of money. A lot of money. $44 billion. So, in New Jersey, in a town called Bayway and Bayonne, they have oil refineries that were running the latter part of the decade and were very inefficient and produced a lot of environmental damage. One source that I will play it when I can, that there was up to 7 to 17 feet of oil diluting in the soil. Exxon clearly was destroying the environment of Bayway and Bayonne, and they should pay for it. We see this a lot, that big oil companies are destroying the areas in which they're operating in, and they pay nothing for it. So ultimately what happened was there was litigation that took place over the latter part of 11 years. And just recently, our governor, or soon to be running for president governor, said that, you know, we struck a deal. 11 years is over. We struck a deal. Courts, stop it. Don't do anything. We struck a deal. And when New Jersey legislators were asking and suing for $8.9 billion, $2.6 for the actual recovery of the area, 6.3 for reparations to the surrounding area and people to kind of revamp in a sense. What happened was we settled. New Jersey actually, you know, said $8.9 billion, that's a lot of money, and we really want that. But our governor decided to settle rather than pursue it. Rather than take on the big corporation that, once again, was hurting the people, our governor decided to go against the popular opinion and settle with the big corporation. So, Rick, if you could play the clip, you know...
pretty, right? For a long time, this refinery was owned and operated by the giant oil company ExxonMobil. 11 years ago, when Jim McGreevy was governor of New Jersey, the state filed a lawsuit against Exxon over this site because of contamination that has occurred over decades on the 1,300 acres of that refinery and another 300 acres nearby. for all that pollution and contamination at that site. New Jersey sued Exxon, seeking $8.9 billion in damages. New Jersey filed the suit in 2004. It has been in the courts ever since. Four different governors have worked on it. And while that 11-year timeline might seem slow for lawsuits, it's also pretty clear what's been happening over the course of this litigation. The courts have described the scale of the contamination in very stark terms. Look at this. It was estimated in 1977 that at least some 7 million gallons of oil, ranging in thickness from 7 feet to 17 feet, is contained in the soil and groundwater underlying a portion of the refinery. 17 feet of oil packed into the soil there. Wow. The court notes that, quote, the documented level of contamination in the waters and sediment of one of the canals nearby is so high that Exxon has recommended just permanently closing the canal and filling it in with an impermeable barrier. That is how bad the contamination is. And the courts have decided already that ExxonMobil did it, that Exxon is liable for having caused all this disgusting damage in New Jersey. When this case went to trial this past year before this judge in Mount Holly, New Jersey, the only issue that was still to be settled was not whether or not Exxon did it, you know, whether they were liable. You know, there wasn't even the question of what exactly Exxon did. When it went to trial last year, the only remaining question was how much Exxon was going to have to pay for it. The dollar amount, that is what remained to be decided. That's what this judge was due to decide. And again, the state of New Jersey, for the last 11 years, has been seeking $8.9 billion in damages from Exxon. They wanted $2.5 billion to essentially repair the damage at those sites, clean them up, and then they wanted another $6 billion to compensate the state for what Exxon had done to this huge swath of land. So that trial, to determine what Exxon owed, that trial lasted from January to September of last year. The last filings happened in November, and after the last filings came in, that judge had been expected to rule at any time. But the New York Times reports today, in a bit of a bombshell, that the Chris Christie administration just settled the case. Remember, the state officially had been seeking $8.9 billion. $8.9 billion. How much did they settle for? Not that. Not even $1 billion. They settled, according to the New York Times, for $250 million.
Okay.
How did New Jersey go from wanting $9 billion to being happy taking a quarter of one?
So, New Jersey was seeking $8.9 billion in essentially to fix up damages, but we settled for $250 million. To put that in a little bit of light, Alex Rodriguez's contract with the New York Yankees is $25 million more than that. He doesn't do anything. So, that was a bad deal, and so is this. you know, I wonder who Chris Christie's donors will be when he runs for president. Maybe we should look at who they are, because this is something that's just sick. Okay? You have the people of New Jersey whose land is now destroyed because of these giant corporations and they're just, I guess, almost immaturity, because they don't take care of what they do, and it's to save profit and time. They do things rather inefficient. Well, they do it for them inefficiently, efficiently, for us inefficiently. And what happens is that the people get screwed in the end, because now, you know who's going to be paying for these cleanups when they run over budget, over the $250 million? The taxpayers, not ExxonMobil, the taxpayers. It's going to be the people of New Jersey who are going to be paying for the cleanup of this mess. It's not going to be ExxonMobil. They're going to pay $250 million. They're not going to pay the full cleanup price. I promise you that. That, you know, when the government says we're going to be able to clean it up for $250 million, they are blowing smoke. The Christie administration has screwed the people once again. That a big corporation is not going to take responsibility for their actions, and I'm not surprised, especially coming from ExxonMobil. This is disgusting, it is sick, and it is not right. At least take responsibility for your actions. I mean, we're talking that this land won't be able to be used or inhabited without it being an environmentally unsafe zone, probably causing cancer. I mean, the other day I was actually riding my bike, and I looked at the sign, and it said EPA hazardous zone. known carcinogens in the soil. And it was in a suburban area. And I was just thinking to myself, like, I wonder if these people know where they live. And I bet the same thing will happen there. And it won't be cleaned up. And the people that we are hurting, the people that the Christie administration just hurt, once again, are the people of New Jersey. So when he runs for president, just remember, he settled with ExxonMobil and he screwed the taxpayers in New Jersey to paying for the cleanup of this site. Because I guarantee you, that's exactly what's going to happen. And it's sick and it's disgusting. And the Christie administration in the state of New Jersey, coming firsthand from me, they are not doing anything right. They promised property taxes to go down. That is yet to happen. They promised income tax to go down. That still has not happened. I mean, he's just another politician. But, I mean, I don't know why so many people have seemed to be in bed with this man. He is destroying a lot of things. I mean, in regard to the environment, in regard to the taxpayers of New Jersey, Chris Christie is a failure. And Rick kind of just made the joke, probably to get campaign money from them. And you know what? I wouldn't be surprised. Because let's look at it this way. ExxonMobil just saved, well, billions of dollars. So you think they would mind giving Chris Christie and some secret, you know, nonprofit organization $20 million to run his presidential campaign? I doubt it. Of course they would. He's just saved them billions of dollars in backdoor backdoor deals. And it's disgusting. What Chris Christie just did, it's disgusting. And I'm so angry about it. And you should be too. Because that man could very well be the next president. And when another BP oil spill happens where it affects multiple states and becomes a federal issue, I wonder how he'll settle it. Because he might just take the easy way out. And he might not stand up for what is right. Because in this situation, he stood up for the corporation, for the small man, for the profit, not for the people. And he clearly forgot about who put him in office. Who voted for him. And that's a problem. He didn't stick up for the people. And that is something I don't respect. But anyways, before I go to break, and before I get into the topic about Iran and Israel, I did do a little discussion last week about standardized tests, and I got pretty pissed off about them. I just took the PARC exam, and that boring as all hell. You know, you give students an online test. What do you think will happen? Of course, something's going to go wrong. It's computerized. It's not pen and paper or pencil and paper. It's computerized. Of course, something will go wrong. You know, Murphy's Law. And just as Murphy's Law stated, it did go wrong. So everybody who took the test as the server crashed had to come back and retake the test, of course. And these tests aren't even being scored, to make sure that we pass. We are simply a guinea pig age, an age of the guinea pig. Because I know that my grade and everybody in New Jersey who's in my grade and the next three grades until 2019 are essentially guinea pigs to find where the standard lies. We need to stop teaching to a test and start teaching to the individual. The problem in this country and with Common Core as a whole is that it focuses on teaching to a test. And I really think that is a huge problem. And coming firsthand on how destructive PARC is to our education system, because it is teaching teachers to teach to a test because their jobs depend on it, our education depends on it. And I literally sat down for 2 hours and I answered 7 questions, wrote an essay, fell asleep for an hour, and that is supposed to grade accurately how well my English teachers throughout high school, 7 questions, is supposed to accurately assess how well I did in high school in English class. But they completely disregard the fact that I have a 97 average in my English class. Does that make sense? No, it doesn't. And that is the answer that I'm looking for. And I think that voters should also be looking at that standardized tests are an unproven way of accurately assessing a standard among a population. And there's been numerous educators who've been outright against it. so many teachers are downright out against it because we are not standard people. And I don't mean to bring it back to last week, but the Park exam was terrible. And if your kids or if you're a kid who's taking a standardized test, I empathize with you and I hope that you get through it well. And one day when you vote, or if your parents are voting, or if you are just a voter in general, look at it carefully and make it clear that you do not support these tests, because, or at least that you support a way to fix these tests, because they are clearly not working. 10 questions in an essay does not accurately assess my knowledge of English or the subject. Okay, I'm going to go to break. Rich, if you could just roll me into break. I am Bryce Robbins here with Opinion Nation, and I will be coming back at you to kind of dissect Bibi Netanyahu's speech to Congress and about Iran. We'll see you right back here. Thank you.
KLCI FM, the best radio station in the world. Coming soon. Stay tuned.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called Therametics. Therametics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our lives is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called Therametics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com.
Hi, I'm Steve Long of Liberty Unfiltered. If you're tired of hearing the same Republican and Democrat banter from the mainstream media, join me on Wednesday nights at 9, 8 Central, as I crawl out of the cesspool of partisan politics and bring the fight for freedom against the advocates of big government to the masses.
The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Tune into The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 5 a.m. as he looks at all the challenges facing the family today. Denny will give you a refreshingly new look at tackling some of the biggest issues. So start your day off on the right foot with Denny C. and The Family Factor, right here on K98Talk.com.
All right, everybody, welcome back. Thank you for being with us this Saturday morning. Okay. So now we are going to be talking about nuclear Iran, Bibi Netanyahu, Obama, and basically how should we be dealing with Iran? So, you know, I haven't really formulated an opinion on this, I mean, clearly yet. But, you know, both sides make an interesting argument. Because historically speaking, let's put this in historical relevance. I actually heard this week a pretty good lecture, and it compared Bibi Netanyahu to Winston Churchill, and Obama to Neville Chamberlain, and Iran, obviously, to Hitler and Nazi Germany. That basically, Obama is the peacemaker, just like Neville Chamberlain in his famous picture coming off a plane with his treaty with Hitler saying, "This is peace in our lifetime." That's basically Obama. Hitler is basically Iran. And Neville Chamberlain is Bibi Netanyahu saying, wait a minute. This is not the road we should be taking. We should be standing up for what we believe in basically militarily. And when it's explained like that, it makes sense. It gives Bibi Netanyahu historical stability. But times have changed, situations do change, and maybe Iran is a different case scenario than Adolf Hitler and Nazi Germany. I think that might be a bit more drastic, but, you know, history may repeat itself when we don't pay attention to it. But let's think about it this way. Iran is an interesting country. Because we like to forget that Iran was, at one point, a Western-style country. Very pro-American, very pro-West. In fact, the West helped make it the way it was. The West also destroyed it. In regard to the the Anglo-Iranian Oil Company is a large reason why Mohammad Mossadegh, the democratically elected parliament leader, was ousted. In a coup led by Britain and America. That's at least one reason. And that created large instability, and we implemented the Shah, who was very pro-America, ended up destroying Iran, led to the Ayatollah Khomeini, who obviously turned Iran into what we know it is today. So this whole destructive Iran is a relatively new situation that we have going in our world. And a lot of times we don't like to believe that because we think that, you know, Islam or anything Muslim is evil to its roots. But here we might need to take a closer look. Now, Bibi Netanyahu, being the leader of the Jewish free world of Israel, makes a clear argument that under, during the Nazis' rule, we had nowhere to go. Nobody wanted to take us in, not even the United States. They've even turned our ships around. And the Jewish people had nowhere to go, they were persecuted against, and that will never happen again. And in that speech, Congress actually got up and applauded, and, you know, Jews in America, there's 6 million Jews in America, and it's safe to say that that probably won't happen again with America's support for the Jewish faith and the Jewish country of Israel. But, again, times have changed, so maybe it is time we make peace with Iran. Because Iran's foreign minister even said that Iran's goal was never to build a bomb. Now, maybe we should take that with a drop of with a grain of salt, but he said that to NBC, and Israel even had reports leaked that, if you all recall, when Bibi Netanyahu was at the UN with his cartoon bomb, said, "We must draw the line here." He was actually lying in regard to how advanced Iran was in their nuclear arsenal, that they're nowhere near making a bomb. But let's look at this carefully. Do we think that Iran would ever launch a nuclear attack on Israel? Maybe under Ahmadinejad, perhaps. Under the current administration, who's in control, the autocratic leaders, I would say probably not. Why does Iran want a nuclear arsenal? To give them legitimacy when negotiating with foreign countries, so they don't keep getting sanctioned like crazy from other nations when Iran doesn't do what they want. I think that is the root kind of goal with their nuclear arsenal. And, you know, Obama, I don't know if he's really appeasing Iran in this situation as Neville Chamberlain did to Hitler. I think that Obama is largely trying to make diplomacy work. And I think that when you're too shut out to negotiation, as it seems Benjamin Netanyahu clearly is, it makes it hard. But let me roll this clip from Benjamin Netanyahu's speech to Congress. Rick, if you could just roll the clip, that'd be great.
Captured weapons and U-2, whereas Iran could soon be armed with intercontinental ballistic missiles and nuclear bombs. We must always remember, I'll say it one more time, the greatest danger facing our world is the marriage of militant Islam with nuclear weapons. To defeat ISIS and let Iran get nuclear weapons would be to win the battle but lose the war.
Okay, so, you know, that statement does hold legitimacy, that Iran is perhaps one of the bigger funders of terrorism around the globe, at least biggest organized funders of terrorism. And even though they stand against ISIS, and they've been clearly out against ISIS, we don't want nuclear technology falling into the wrong hands. I mean, if you don't consider the Russians the wrong hands. But, you know, this is really a tricky situation, and I'm not really sure how you deal with it, because to make peace with Iran would to have a key center point in the Middle East as an ally. I'm not saying that they'd be an ally immediately or overnight, but that might be a good way to move. But on the other hand, we could see something bad happen, where if we kind of let this slide, we could learn a lesson from history that they will just keep going and going and going till it's too late. Now, if Iran did get a nuclear weapon and did launch war on Israel, it would be mutually assured destruction because, let's not forget, Israel already does have nuclear missiles. I believe it is 11 or something like that. But, you know, the argument is, it holds very strong for both sides. Where I'm falling is more that, you know, Israel is a great nation, but they need to start giving a little more in regard to, to appease. And I use that word very carefully. But they already have illegal settlements. And whoever you are, if you denounce that they're illegal settlements, in the eyes of the international community and in regard to the treaties that they have signed, current settlements in their West Bank are illegal. And the expansion of these West Banks are kind of like a spit in the face to the people of Palestine or the Palestinian people. And that is just a huge reason why peace in that region will never be made. Let's not forget, the Jews and Arabs largely lived in peace together under the Ottoman Empire. We forget that. And we say that this problem is thousands of years old. You know, I wouldn't go that far to say it's thousands of years old. The problem really started over land disputes when Britain handed the land of Israel over to the United Nations to decide how it would be divvied up and settled. So that's really when the problem dates. It's really about land. And then it's become a cultural dispute, and that's where we are today. Now, to get back to my main point about a nuclear-armed Iran, are they the biggest threat? Is what Benjamin Netanyahu is saying true? It's really tough because we don't know. Are they nuts enough to pull a trigger and send a nuclear weapon over to Israel? You know, this is really a question I think that will be answered in the next couple months. I think that, you know, I'm very interested to see what treaty or what comes out of the talks between the U.S. and Iran, because reports showed that this past Wednesday, a foreign minister from Iran and the United States both stated that we are very close to a deal, days away. That might have been Wednesday, excuse me. So I'm really interested to see where this goes because, you know, I was very outspoken against the United States funding these autocratic leaders, and I still am, and I think we should be in opposition to them. But in the sense of Iran, considering that they once were a Western-style country, that those people aren't even dead yet, that those people probably still live in that country, I'm very interested to see how Iran could change, how the future will shape if the United States and the world can strike a deal with Iran, because I think it's like a domino effect. I think Iran is probably the most likely to tilt its ways, maybe other than Egypt, because, you know, since the Arab Springs, Egypt has not been very stable and still remained largely unstable. But, you know, I think this is very interesting, and I cannot wait to see it. So, let's keep moving on, though, with this point, with nuclear-armed Iran. One could even make the argument, why is it even necessary to have nuclear weapons? Why should we even entertain the thought that you want nuclear weapons, so we should, for whatever reason, appease you and then give you nuclear weapons? That's ridiculous. You've been known to cause terror. You've been known to harm other countries and fund terror. So the complete notion that you want nuclear weapons is a joke. Now, we could look at it like that, and I understand why Benjamin Netanyahu does. But I think that we need to move through history as well, and we need to kind of, in order to fix the future, we must look towards the past, we must look towards the current situation, and assess it from there. It is very interesting, though, how it is playing out, and I think John Boehner deciding to bring Bibi Benjamin to speak at Congress, you know, the media really played it up like it was a slap in the face to Obama. And it's kind of wrong that, you know, Benjamin Netanyahu's in the middle of an election. But it's kind of interesting because, you know, he is just speaking out against something that he views as wrong. And, you know, it's really tough to form an opinion on this one. You know, being an American Jew, I do understand the reasoning why it is important to have a Jewish state, why it is important to support Israel. But Israel does largely act as an, not an aggressor, because Israel is not instigating issues, but the retaliation method that Israel uses is kind of like if I were to flick Rick a bunch of times, and then Rick just socked me in the face. That's kind of how it goes, and I don't know if that is the best method when dealing with these countries that are largely underdeveloped. And I think that perhaps this diplomatic move by Obama might be the right way to go, but that is yet to be discovered. Next, I'm going to move on to a different topic, but I must just say, please tweet me at OPNATnews so I can hear your insight on this issue. Message me or inbox me or whatever it's called. Post on Opinion Nation News on Facebook. Post your opinions. Let's get the spark of conversation into a fire, because I really want to hear what we all have to say. I actually have to look at Rick sent me over a network email address that I will be talking about next week that we can all that you can email me at, and I can hear what you have to say. I know, I do have an email. I actually haven't even looked at it yet because I've just been so busy in regard to everything, but I will definitely, post that on my Facebook, post that on my Twitter. I will get that out there, and I demand that I hear back from you and your opinions, Nation. But now let's move on to race relations in the United States. And this is kind of just something that I was talking about with a couple friends the other day. And I thought it'd be interesting to bring up now. You know, between Ferguson and Eric Garner, however you look at it, I mean, I view Ferguson that it's very gray, but it's more understandable. You know, it just kind of... I don't want to say straight up that Michael Brown was a... I don't want to say that Michael Brown was necessarily a thug, but, well, I'll let you fill it in with your own words. But Eric Garner, that case was kind of just screwed up. I mean, he was a convicted felon, and he was arrested 31 times or something like that. But my point is that the news polarizes race relations in the United States and subsequently makes it worse in the United States. And basically, let me break it down like this. MSNBC says, oh my goodness, these white oppressors, these white men who are shooting innocent black people, Black Lives Matter, this and that. And then you have Fox News who says these black thugs, they are, you know, hurting society. And they're just such polar opposites. And then the people get their media and their news from these two sources quite frequently. And you only really hear the two ends. We hear Al Sharpton from MSNBC and Jesse Jackson, saying how, you know, we've come so far, but we are still so far away from having equality. And then you hear, you know, Hannity and Bill O'Reilly. Mind you, Bill O'Reilly grew up in an all-white neighborhood, saying, you know, that's not true. There's no more racism in this country, whatever. And really, it just polarizes the arguments. So either if you're left, you tend to believe that we're still a racist nation. And if you're on the right and watch Fox News, you tend to believe that black people are thugs in this country, and that's why they're all getting shot. There needs to be a common ground here where we stop looking at these two polar ends and look at what is actually happening. And in many instances, young black men are getting shot a lot more frequently than white men. But just look socioeconomically, who's causing more crime, as well as who is just in these areas on these streets committing which types of crimes. And we will see that we have to look at it through the cops' eyes as well. They're fearing for their lives. But ultimately, I just want to make the point clear that I think racism in this country is exacerbated by people like Al Sharpton. The very people who claim that they're fighting against racism are actually making the problem worse. Because by saying, you know, these outrageous comments before a jury or trial even takes place, by making all these statements and then having your own show on MSNBC for millions of people to see, and you just flood them with these opinions, that is a problem. That's not journalism, that's not news, that is garbage being shoved down the American people's throats. Al Sharpton is, I want to say, in a sense, creating a sense of reverse racism, where by saying how bad the situations are, he's actually making it worse. And for that reason, it's a problem. Rick just messaged me, millions, really? I would say a great deal of people, unfortunately, do watch Al Sharpton. He's a something else. But then we look at Fox News and we see millions of people watching Bill O'Reilly, Hannity, whatever, and they are giving their opinions on how, you know, blacks are thugs, blacks are this and that. And then we look at the case with Eric Garner, that just seemed kind of screwed up. The guy got a chokehold done on him, and when he asked for help, nobody came. So, all in all, I do think that racism in this nation, the problem, is a festering issue that is largely caused by the polar ends of the media. And when we want to get our news from these sources, just realize where they're coming from. That MSNBC is going to give you the left, left, left view, and Fox News is going to give you the right, right, right view. They're not always right. They're just on the right. Ha, no pun intended. But again, just, it gets me frustrated that there was one point in our history where each and every day the news was on its way. And at 6 o'clock every night, the family could turn on the news and hear a trusted reporter like Brian Williams, just kidding, report the news. Just the news. And they wouldn't say, like, you know, Obama cannot do anything right by the American people. And you wouldn't hear people say, Obama is the greatest president in the world and he should run for 5 more terms, as MSNBC would put it. You know, so we hear these two polar ending opinions, and that ultimately hurts the people's knowledge in the United States, because this is where we get our information from, these companies. All right. Well, to wrap up today's show in the last couple minutes, I kind of want to do a brief overview of everything. So we covered Chris Christie and how he's an awful person and how if he ever becomes president of the United States, I'll be kind of scared. But again, let's look at the other options. We have Ben Carson, who is screwed his campaign over by making his gay statements on NBC that people choose to be gay. And whether me and Rick talked about this in the last show of Finding Common Ground, that whether or not you believe it is your choice or it is just you're born that way, personally, I believe you're just born that way. I think that it's in your DNA. You know, you didn't choose to have brown hair, brown eyes. I don't see why you would choose to fall in love with somebody or not. But however you view it, I think the large majority, probably the enough people to make it so that he won't get a nomination or get elected. So I think Ben Carson, we can stop viewing as a threat. And I think that we can view him as more of a threat to people like Rand Paul, because he's going to be taking votes away. Kind of, that's just what's going to happen. He's going to be taking votes away from people who actually might be a good contender in the race. Jeb Bush, we might consider him almost out. The CPAC poll put him in last place with getting, I think it was like 8% of the vote. Shocking. And it's interesting to see how that is shaping up, because, you know, the media portrayed him as somebody who was really going to take this by storm and just didn't. Kind of fell flat on his face. I guess we are not going to see Mitt Romney running because he counted himself out. Rick Santorum, we're not going to be really seeing running because he's made odd statements about not running and then statements about running, and I think we can kind of just count him out. The Republican Party is really not putting up anybody great. You know what they need to find, though? Someone of a minority race. Not Marco Rubio, who's made ridiculous comments about almost everything, but we need to find somebody. The Republican Party really needs to find somebody who can come at a middle perspective, not a Tea Party perspective, and someone who can actually connect with people. The problem is that we have these rich, white, old men, typically, preaching about their beliefs. And, you know, how can you fix poverty if you've never seen poverty? That's the problem that a lot of people had against Mitt Romney, and I think that's a big problem that they're going to face again today. Don't get me wrong. As you heard in the last show, I don't agree with Hillary Clinton on a lot of things, and I just feel like I can't trust her. So that is why I will donate the last 5 minutes to pontificating the presidency of Elizabeth Warren. And I know Rick is on the other end right now, just kind of with his mouth open like in the cartoons, crying, trying to cover his ears so he doesn't hear this. Could you imagine a Warren-Sanders ticket? By God. Now that would be something. Elizabeth Warren running for president of the United States with Bernie Sanders by her side. Now, I think I just, might have killed Rick. He's telling me he's trying to vomit. I talked about this in the last show, but Elizabeth Warren just seems like someone you can really trust, and she seems like she's really kind of taking Washington by the balls and kind of just going strong against these giant corporations, something that Chris Christie didn't do. And as big as Chris Christie is and as big of a bully that he is, he's a wimp when it comes down to the money factor. He kissed Sheldon Adelson's ass. He apologized for statements that he made that could have seemed offensive to Sheldon Adelson, so that he would be a potential candidate for his support in this upcoming election. Okay, clearly he kissed Exxon's ass, because I wonder who his funding is going to be coming from. And Chris Christie's a wimp. He is a wimp. He comes off as a bully, saying, you know, you're stupid, shut up, to all these people who speak out against him. But at the end of the day, when you have a big enough buck in your pocket, Chris Christie's going to bow down to you. And you know who's not? Or you know at least who seems like they're not? Elizabeth Warren. That's one reason that she is so admired in my eyes. And I think that everybody should just give her a look and maybe a round of applause. Regardless of whether side of the aisle you side on, she just genuinely seems like she is a person with good intentions for Washington. That she's going to fight the corruption, the money factor in Washington. And I think that's exactly what Washington needs. I think that to fight this problem of growing income inequality, to Rick's telling me just blue chunks. whether or not you're conservative or not, you kind of just admire somebody who's trying to change the system. I would admire if somebody ran as a Republican and said, you know, we have a problem in this country. The greatest way to solve a problem is acknowledging that there is one. American politics has a love affair with these giant corporations and giant funders. It seems like we always have. But we need people like Elizabeth Warren who are not engaged in that love affair, who want to break free, who want to come out of that realm and put politics where it should be for the people, not for the money. Because that's exactly what Chris Christie just did. We literally just saw him skimp out on a deal of a lifetime that would have given the state $9 billion to repair the destroyed area, settle for $250 million. Mind you, that's literally Prince Fielder's contract, or $25 million less than A-Rod's contract. And that is the deal that he made. That is the deal, that is how much that land is worth to him. That is the amount of money that he just gave, yeah, he just took instead of the $9 billion that probably would have come to the state if he let the courts handle it. I wonder what happened. What was the incentive behind that? Because that is not kosher. That is not right. That is, something is wrong, and it disgusts me. Okay. Whatever. You know, I'm done with my Elizabeth Warren love affair for this week and my Christie outcry for this week. To end my show, I just kind of want to give a little kind of uplifting news. So lately, I haven't really had a lot of guests on my show, and I've kind of been disappointed about that, because I do like feeding off other people, and I like other people bringing their opinions to the table. In fact, this is called Opinionation News for a reason, because I want the opinions of the people, the opinions of the nation, and I want to deliver you the news. But so first off, if you want to be a guest on my show, please contact me. Tweet me at OPNAT News, Opinionation News on Facebook. Just give me an outreach and I will talk. But in regards to guests, I've been talking to State Senator Loretta Weinberg of New Jersey. She might be coming on by the end of the month. And I've been in contact with Andrew Cuomo's office. I called his office. They said, oh, this sounds actually very interesting. And they gave me the email to his press office, and I'm in contact with them. So maybe we might see him come on in the future. But again, if you have contacts or if you just want to come on the show, please feel free, because I really enjoy, whether you're right or you're left, I want to have debate, I want to have talk, I want to do what Washington won't, and kind of find, as Rick's show is called, find common ground. And I want to leave us on this last thought. You know, it's kind of random, but I was talking about with my friend, and I want people's opinions on this. Obamacare is it has good intentions to get people covered. That's undeniable. The previous system didn't work as well, that people who had pre-existing conditions were just left out. That is just one area, at least, where Obamacare does its job. It gets people insured. Ultimately, though, it was written by the pharmaceutical companies, and if you don't look at it like that, then you're blowing smoke. The pharmaceutical companies and giants wrote Obamacare so that, because they saw it as an opportunity. Whenever you hear the statistic, Obamacare just signed up 14 million more people to be insured. Yeah, great. That means the pharmaceutical companies have 14 million more patients or customers that are going to be paying into their systems. And here's a big problem, is that, you know, it's still based off this corporate, it's still basically run and operated by corporate America. And we look at the Canadian system, which works pretty darn well. I mean, it gets the job done, it gets people insured, and it works a heck of a lot more efficient than ours. Even if you look at Europe's system, it gets the job done more than ours, and we can still implement free market strategies to ensure that efficiency stays at a high percent, that we still take efficiency into, that we still look at efficiency as our greatest aspect, and we put the improvement of technology and the free market, kind of upfront. Because that's the biggest worry, that, you know, since they have these socialist ideas, that there is a lack of movement or progress in their medical spectrum or in their medical area. But me and my friend, my conservative friend, were actually talking, and we decided that what if we took Canada's pay it forward system, and we put it on state exchanges. Okay, so here's my idea. Just hear me out, and I want to hear your opinions back. We take Canada's system, modify it a little bit, right? We put the pay it forward system into state exchanges so that the free market is still available for the people, that you can still seek insurance in other states, but a state system that is a pay-forward system that is not nationalized through basically how Obamacare is, how would that work out? Would that work? And would it be the best system possible? Because it would be done by the state. It would be a pay-it-forward system, which means that millions of people would continue to get access to be insured. It would kind of be like a public-private partnership in a sense. But I really want to hear what you think about that, because that was an interesting thing that popped into my head. Okay, I'm running a little bit past my time, even though I did start a little late. I'm going to go now. So thank you for being with me this Saturday afternoon or morning, whatever you want to call it. I am going to press for more guests on the show. So again, tweet me at OPNAT News, Facebook Opinion Nation News, or even tweet me at my regular Twitter, Robbins Bryce. And I can't wait to hear from you. So thank you for being with us. And Rick, if you could just take us out.
All right, folks, we'll be back live here in just a minute with America Off the Rails. This will conclude Opinion Nation for this week. Again, just want to give a shout out to Bryce. Good job. Great show as always, especially since I know you are trying to push for guests. You do a really good job holding things together even when they don't come through for you. So just keep doing what you're doing. All right, we're going to go ahead and take things out with a bumper. Then we're going to play some commercials. And then I will be right back to rant, rave, yell, scream, all the normal stuff I usually do on Saturday.
Have a great weekend, everybody.